Our speaker this morning is somebody who is a frequent flyer. And I know that she not only flies in planes, but she also flies in spirit. So I know that our message this morning comes from those celestial heights. So welcome our speaker, practitioner Jennifer Williams.
Thank you, Pastor. Good morning, friends. Let me also add my own words of welcome to all of you and to those of you tuned into this service on the World Wide Web. Let me say it's truly an honor to share with you from the podium on a Sunday morning in whatever capacity I'm assigned to do so. And today I have the opportunity to share some thoughts with you on a topic that only recently Reverend Michael also shared with us in his message on the second Sunday, and it surrounds this matter of consciousness. Now, friends, since my trip earlier this year to a company convention in Spain, and then for a few days after, where I went off on my own to see more of Europe, spending 4 days in Italy, I have had this topic circulating in my mind, and it is this: life is consciousness. In preparing for this talk, I discovered that this is also the title of a book by Emmet Fox, based on a lecture he had given to the Unity School of Christianity in 1936. So I want to begin with a quote from that lecture, which states, "The explanation of all your problems, the explanation of your difficulties, and the explanation of your triumph in life boils down to this: life is a state of consciousness. That is the beginning and the end." End of that quote. How did I come to this realization? I looked back on my experiences, more so in this particular trip, where I knew no one in Italy. I was traveling by myself, and yet I had the most fantastic time and met the most wonderful people, whose English is not their first language to begin with, while yours truly spoke no Italian, absolutely none. But they were so helpful and willing to assist that something in me knew that we were communicating with each other on another level, the level of consciousness. So what is this consciousness to which I am referring? Consciousness refers to awareness, the awareness that there is an inner presence in everyone and everything. That presence is God. And it, as incarnations of God, the living spirit, it breathes through us all. When we recognize this spirit, it responds to us and reaches out to commune with the spirit in everyone and everything we contact. Spiritual awareness is important in the use of the law of life, for the law is a servant of the spirit. In our Science of Mind textbook, our founder, Dr. Ernest Holmes, states, and I quote, "The spirit is not something apart from matter, so-called, but is something working through matter, the potential possibility of what we call the highest and the lowest is inherent in everything. They are not different things," end quote. We may look at life from different mental depths or heights, but from whatever level we look, what we see comes back to us by an invariable law of attraction. The law of attraction, as stated in the Science of Mind textbook, begins with our thoughts. It is our thoughts that will attract to us that which we first mentally embody. It goes on to explain that each of us is surrounded by a thought atmosphere, and it is from this that we determine that which comes into our lives. Dr. Holmes goes on to state, and I quote, "Everyone automatically attracts to himself just what he is. And we may set it down that wherever we are, however intolerable the situation may be, we are just where we belong. There is no power in the universe but ourselves, and that can free us, end quote. Yes, friends, this is the principle that we attract that to which our thoughts is attuned. In so doing, we must first mentally embody the good we seek and have it become a part of our inner understanding. This consciousness of good is made manifest through our use of the law of attraction. However, the universe can only give us what we take, and since our taking is a thing of consciousness, the universe can only give us what we are aware of and are open and ready to receive. Friends, are you ready to receive? Are you?
Yes.
Okay. This brings us to our first tool that we can use for the purpose of bringing our consciousness to a higher level of spiritual acceptance through the use of spiritual mind healing treatment or affirmative prayer. The phrase, "Are you ready to receive?" embodies the five steps of treatment. Here is an example of a treatment of abundance using these five steps. Step one, recognition. There is only one presence and power, God, and God is abundance. Step two, unification. I am one with this presence and power, therefore I am one with this abundance. Step three, reaffirmation. The abundance, which is God, now circulates fully and freely through every area of my life. Step four, thanksgiving. I accept this abundance now with heartfelt joy and thanksgiving. And step five is release. I release this word to the law of mind for its fulfillment here and now, knowing that this is already so, and so it is. This simple acronym, "Are you ready to receive?" makes it simple for us to recall the steps, whether you are a beginner or a seasoned practitioner in using affirmative prayers. While we know how effective our affirmative prayers can be, unless we change our states of consciousness, we cannot change our condition. In fact, every area of our life reflects our state of consciousness. So if you're in a job that you like or you do not like, that is as a result of your state of consciousness. Our bodies, our bank accounts, our homes, our cities, everything that we have, do, or are being is in accord with our consciousness. For example, let's take this matter of healing. You cannot get a permanent healing unless you have a consciousness of health. You may treat for the healing of one illness, and no sooner that we are over this, then another illness appears. And you get over that, and then on to the next. Without a consciousness of health, you cannot cheat nature. The same is true if you find you have persons in your life who you do not like. Emmet Fox's advice to us is that we take a 4x5 card and write the following words on there. Like attracts like. It is our consciousness that brought them into our experience. When we try to work on the outer things without a change on the inner, it can bring no permanent change. The story is told of in the old days of cowboys and Indians, and I'm not sure, this is not my story. In the Midwest, when movies first came to town, these were shown in the square on a huge white screen with the projector rolling. In one scene where the villain was holding the damsel in distress, by the throat as if to strangle her. A cowboy in the audience took out his pistol and fired a shot at the screen. But that didn't rescue the damsel or stop the show. It only resulted in a hole in the screen. If the cowboy really wanted to stop the movie, he should have fired at the projector. What picture are you seeing on the screen of your life? Think about it, that you do not like. We can change the real by changing our consciousness. This also reminds me of what our founding minister, Dr. Elmer, always said. And she would say, if our hair is messed up when we look in the mirror, there's no point in combing the reflection that we see there. We must comb the hair if we want a different reflection. And I'm sure you have heard that from Dr. Elmer. Friends, this brings us to some of the other tools we can use in helping us to change our consciousness and to rise above our situations. First, affirmations. We can repeat some positive affirmation when we find ourselves face to face with any negative situation. And here are a few examples. I will say them once and you can repeat after me. So the first is, God is my sufficiency. Together, God is my sufficiency. Next, I am surrounded by the presence of God and all is well in my world. Together, I am surrounded by the presence of God and all is well in my world. All power is given unto me. I have dominion over everything that appears in my life. All power is given unto me. I have dominion over everything that appears in my life. Yes, it is true that affirmations are helpful when we find ourselves faced with any kind of negative situation. So you need to have a storehouse of those that you can use and easily recall. Next is our daily spiritual practice. Many of us do the practice of meditation and quiet contemplation, and this also helps to bring about a change in our consciousness. If you do not know how to meditate, then please call the office for an appointment to learn how to do so. And also, reading. I know many of us are avid readers. However, we have all the truth books and we have them beside our bedside tables and we don't open one of them very often. But friends, reading our truth literature and of course reading our Bible can also help us in changing our consciousness. Yes, daily reading of the Bible can help us in bringing about a change in our consciousness as we learn the truths of life which set free. One such truth is found in St. John chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. And in the King James Version, we read, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made." End of that reading. This is a reflection of the first chapter of Genesis, in which God, the great creator, spoke things into being through the power of the word. And if you note, our session on discovery this morning is on the power of the word. One mind. Given that the essence of man's life is God, it follows that we use the same creative process. And one such great creative word that we encounter in Deuteronomy and which Jesus, the master teacher, identified himself with is the I Am. It is the name of God. It is the key to life. And it is with us all the time. It is the great secret which one can unlock when we know the power of the I Am. Friends, this word is any definitively formulated thought. It is creative, and whatever follows our I Am determines what the universe will bestow upon us. We must be mindful, therefore, of how we use our I am statements, because we are writing blank checks on the universe for future use. So make sure you are writing that which will heal, uplift, inspire, prosper, and bless. Remember that no one can say, I am for you. We build our consciousness with our I am statements, and no one can do it for us. Emmet Fox also points out in his lecture that many persons come to him and say that they spend an hour every morning working on building their consciousness through meditation and quiet contemplation. But he reminds us that it is not the hour that is spent that determines our consciousness, but what it is that we continue to maintain and sustain throughout our day that is in keeping with building this uplifted consciousness. So we cannot just have finished our meditation and we get on the road, heading to the office in traffic, when another driver cuts us off and we totally lose it. Or we go into work and we do not want to deal with those tiresome co-workers, so we avoid them at all costs. It is for this reason that Joel Goldsmith, in his book, The Heart of Mysticism, recommends that we take frequent breaks throughout the day to go within for periods of silence and quiet communion. It is worthwhile for us to consider putting this into practice, since trying to work on outer things without a change on the inner can bring no permanent change. In his book, Consciousness Unfolding, Goldsmith also points out the purpose of this study of truth, and it is that God may reveal itself as our individual consciousness. He states, and I quote, "The beginning of wisdom is when we draw our attention away from the outer world, from the world of effect or appearance, and begin to realize that power is not in it, but in me." End quote. Friends, we are always either attracting or repelling in accordance with our mental attitudes, just as we are either identifying ourselves with lack or with abundance, with health or with illness, with friendship or with loneliness. And we cannot keep from attracting into our experience that which is in accord with our state of consciousness. This law of attraction or repulsion works automatically and will always reflect back to us that which we believe to be true about ourselves. Our life is a mirror, and its reflection bears all the forms of our own acceptance. How careful, then, we each must be in guarding our thoughts and our beliefs. It does not mean that we are not aware of what happens in the world around us, but we will go about our affairs doing those things in accordance with our higher consciousness. And we will see results outpictured in our world as joy, peace, love, and prosperity. In closing, as I did in the beginning, I do so with a quote from Emmet Fox, "Life is Consciousness," in which he states, "When you want to solve your problems or change your life, you can see at once that the only way is to change your consciousness." Namaste.